Good morning, all. Good morning. Our liturgy this morning is Divine Service 3. Our opening hymn is hymn number 804. The Lord bless your worship. Thank you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you of your boundless mercy and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in the stead, by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let the sea roar and all that fills it, the world and those who dwell in it. He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with equity. The Lord has made known his salvation. He has revealed his righteousness in the sight of the nations. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. Glory be to God on high, and on earth peace, good will toward men. We bless thee, we worship thee, we glorify thee, we give thanks to thee for thy great glory. Thank you.
Thou only art the Lord. Thou only, O Christ, with the Holy Ghost, art most high in the glory of God the Father.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O Lord, graciously hear the prayers of your people, that we who justly suffer the consequences of our sin may be mercifully delivered by your goodness to the glory of your name. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Old Testament for the sixth Sunday after the Epiphany is from Deuteronomy chapter 30. See, I have set before you today life and good, death and evil. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I command you today, by loving the Lord your God, by walking in his ways, and by keeping his commandments and his statutes and his just decrees, then you shall live and multiply, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to take possession of it. But if your heart turns away, and you will not hear, but are drawn away to worship other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall surely perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are going over the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessing and curse. Therefore, choose life, that you and your offspring may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying his voice, and holding fast to him, for he is your life and length of days, that you may dwell in the land that the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give to them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. For great is his steadfast love toward us, and the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever. The epistle for this day is from 1 Corinthians chapter 3. I, brothers, could not address you as spiritual people, but as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for it. And even now, you are not ready, for you are still of the flesh. For while there is jealousy and strife among you, are you not of the flesh and behaving only in a human way? For when one says, I follow Paul, and another, I follow Apollos, are you not being merely human? What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you believed, as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. He who plants and he who waters are one, and each will receive his wages according to his labor. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 5th chapter.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
You have heard that it was said to those of old, "You shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment." But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council, and whoever says, "You fool," will be liable to the hell of fire. So if you're offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are going with him to court, lest your accuser hand you over to the judge and the judge to the guard and you be put in prison. Truly I say to you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. You've heard that it was said, "You shall not commit adultery." But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. For it is better that you lose one of your members than that your whole body be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off, throw it away. For it is better that you lose one of your members than that your whole body go into hell. It was also said, "Whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce." But I say to you that everyone who divorces his wife, except on the ground of sexual immorality, makes her commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that it was said to those of old, "You shall not swear falsely, but shall perform to the Lord what you have sworn." But I say to you, do not take an oath at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great King. And do not take an oath by your head, for you cannot make one hair black or white. Let what you say be simply yes or no. Anything more than this comes from evil. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, from our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Today's gospel is from our Lord's Sermon on the Mount. Here Jesus says, among other things, do not hold anger. Do not mess around with people to whom you're not married, and hold on to the man or woman you did marry. Keep a careful watch over the things you say, so that you say no more than needs to be said. Dear Christian friends, last week we baptized two children here at Trinity, one on Saturday, one on Sunday. Quick as I get out of here, I'm going to run over to Versailles and baptize another one at Grace. These events remind all God's Christians that we each have something profitable to do with our spare time. We can pray God. We can plead with parents that the children of the church do not forget their Lord and Christ as soon as their hair gets dry. Most of us here are separated by a generation or two or three from those who have just been baptized. But in baptism, we're all one. The benefits you received in baptism, however many years ago, are as fresh and as new for you today as those just baptized. Every passage in God's Bible should be read and heard in light of baptism. Baptismal sermons might be fairly easy to spot when the word baptism appears written in the verse you're reading, or at least when water appears there. But only a few verses explicitly mention baptism or water. Countless other Bible passages do not. These others are not quite so easy to milk. We should nevertheless feel absolutely confident that God's miracle of baptism is ever present in the Scriptures, even in those places where the word is not spelled out or we cannot yet see the point. Today's gospel is one such Bible passage. The words baptism and water do not appear in this gospel in print. In this gospel, Jesus warns us against anger, describing anger as a mental act of murder. Essentially, Jesus is saying to each of us in this gospel, if you stay angry, you will go to hell. In this gospel, Jesus warns us against sexual immorality and ignoring marriage. Here, Jesus even describes the mental picture of sexual sin as worthy of punishment. In this gospel, Jesus warns us against flippant oaths and solemn lies. Let what you say be simply yes and no, says the Lord. Anything else than this comes from evil. None of this would have anything to do with the gift and miracle of baptism, at least in outward appearances. The words baptism and water do not even appear in this gospel. But here's the thing about your baptism into Christ. Baptism is something more than a sticker God puts onto your shirt, like the kind you get when you've just voted or just given blood. By all means, God labels you and identifies you as his child in the water. But that's not all God does for you there. Baptism is also not just another item on the to-do list, along with taking the baby pictures and sending out the birth announcements. Absolutely, God requires us to bring our children to baptism, and guilty are the parents who fail or who unnecessarily delay in doing so. But baptism was not given to us by God simply so that we can get it done and check it off the list. Amazingly, baptism is even something more than God's pledge of forgiveness and promise of eternal life. Like it or not, we're all sinners, right down to the newborns. In baptism, God washes away sin. And where sin gets washed away, there new life and faith spring up and grow. But that's still not all that God has done for you there. Among these other things, Baptism is your personal entry into God's scriptures. If the Bible can be compared to a bucket, then baptism is God's way of throwing you into the bucket. The Bible is a book, and baptism is like a little trap door right there on the spine of the book. When God baptizes you, he pushes you through the door so that you may walk through the pages of the scriptures, knowing that each and every line is written to you, about you, for you. If you like computer terms, baptism is how the Lord our God wants to click, drag, and drop you into his Bible. You are now directly connected to God's Word because he baptized you. The words of the Bible are your words because of your baptism. And more to the point, today's gospel, you're now directly connected to the Sermon on the Mount because you are a baptized one. Jesus, our God, speaks to all the baptized ones in today's gospel. Everyone who's angry with his brother will be liable for judgment. Jesus, in today's gospel, describes to us the sorts of places that baptism does not wish for us to go. And he does so by saying, everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Jesus speaks the faith and the confidence and the fearlessness that God gives to us in baptism when he says in today's gospel, let your word be yes or no. Anything else is simply from evil. But there are going to be some consequences for us if baptism is connected to the Sermon on the Mount. We might need to wonder whether we want baptism to be connected to the Sermon on the Mount. What I mean is this. When the Sermon on the Mount describes the baptismal life, we then become able to see that our native impulses, our anger, our lust, our boasting, these native impulses are nothing more than a denial of baptism. Stated another way, when we live as if God does not matter and as if we matter most, we essentially say to God that his gift of baptism made no significant difference for us, neither in the way we live our lives nor in the way we order our thinking. What then is repentance? Repentance is a return to baptism. State another way, baptism's connection to the Sermon on the Mount also helps us see how we can come back from those selfish things that we most deeply desire to do and continue doing. When anger rises, when lust burns, when the tongue begins to loosen and flap, we can each run back to God's baptismal font. We can each return to baptism 1,000 times a day even by making the sign of the Holy Cross and praying, Lord, I am baptized, help me. Perhaps even closing our eyes and making the sign of the cross could be the best way of cutting off our sinful hand and plucking out our sinful eye. But there's something else. When baptism gets connected to the Sermon on the Mount, we get a whole new picture of our Lord Jesus Christ. After all, Jesus is the baptized one. You know how it happened? Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to John, who baptized him. And when Jesus was baptized, immediately he went up from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove, coming to rest on him. Behold, a voice from heaven said, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. And because Jesus is the baptized one, the Sermon on the Mount describes his life in the same way that it describes the lives of all the baptized ones. Jesus speaks here about everyone who is angry. Anger is itself an act of judgment. But Jesus is the baptized one. And that means Jesus is not the angry one. Jesus holds no anger against us because he suffered the judgment and the punishment that was once due to us, and all reasons for judgment are now dead and gone. Therefore, all reasons for any anger from our God are dead and gone. Jesus speaks here about everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent. Lust is nothing more than self-gratification at the expense of others. Jesus is the baptized one, and that means he is not the lustful one. Jesus feels no urge to victimize me or to exploit you in order to achieve his goals. His entire attraction to us is a pure, selfless love devoted exclusively to our well-being alone. Jesus speaks here about letting what you say be simply yes or no. Oaths get taken away as a way of guarding against dishonesty. Jesus is the baptized one. His baptism declares him to be the honest one and the faithful one. There's not a single shred of dishonesty or unreliability in our Lord's entire being. His oaths are not spoken for the sake of his reputation, but for the sake of our comfort, our assurance, our peace. Every time we bring a child to the font, that child receives in the water the same things that you and I have already been given in the water. In these things we continually share. For here at the font, that's where our fellowship is given birth. Here we get Jesus. Here we get his forgiveness and his life and his guaranteed resurrection from the dead. Here, too, we get his Sermon on the Mount. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let's sing our offering.
Thank you.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, you are a loving, faithful, truthful God. You have made us your children and called us your people. Enable us by your Spirit to be loving, faithful, and truthful. Curb our anger. Help us to be reconciled one with another. Shield our eyes from lust. Help us to look upon one another with the love of brothers and sisters whom you have created. Guard our lips, that we may not use them to speak deceitfully, but to praise your name, and to comfort our neighbors, and to speak your word. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious Lord, long ago you sent Paul and Apollos to plant and to water the seed of your word. By your grace, you caused it to grow. So also cause your seed to grow among us today. Train and send pastors and church workers to do the planting and the watering. And give us patience to watch it grow. Send us pastors to Trinity and to Holy Cross and St. John according to your will. Bless Pastor Truey and Pastor Gibbs as they deliberate their calls. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Lord, look down from heaven and behold your servants who are weary, heavy laden, and afflicted with any sort of grief in body or mind. Give them your comfort. Use us, your servants, as your instruments of mercy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, every one of your baptized children always stands at the crossroads of life and good, death and evil. Continually pour out upon us your Holy Spirit, that we may walk in your ways, that we may indeed be blameless before you by the forgiveness that is ours in Christ, and that we may be devoted to keeping your word. Do not let our hearts turn toward other gods, but keep them fixed on you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, dear Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Let us pray. O God the Father, the fountain and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. We ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Bless we the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen. Amen. Amen.